Hey, yo, what is a cipher?
Is it time for me to get my shot?
You. The knowledge of the cipher is to enlighten you.
Where you think the cipher come from? The gods.
Because you tried to jump the cipher and it goes this way.
Welcome to The Cipher, a weekly podcast where we bring you conversations with the most interesting figures in hip-hop and culture. I'm your host, Sean Sotero. This is episode 109, a talk with photographer Janette Beckman. Janette has taken some of the most iconic photos out there, not only of hip-hop, but of music and youth culture as a whole. She got her start in Britain in the late 1970s, using her art school education to take photos of the then-burgeoning punk movement, including some great shots of our episode 106 guest, Johnny Rotten. But in 1982, she saw the very first international hip-hop tour and was so taken by the music and culture that she hopped on a plane to New York City and never left. She has taken classic photos of LL Cool J, Salt-N-Pepa, N.W.A., Slick Rick, Big Daddy Kane, Afrika Bambaataa, and tons more. She's also shot classic album and single covers for the likes of EPMD, Ultramagnetic MCs, Run-DMC, Gangstar, The Police, and others. And if that wasn't enough, she's also done popular photo series on Mexican street gangs, Harlem bikers, and women's underground fight clubs. You can see Janette's photos for yourself through September 13th at the Museum of the City of New York in Manhattan. Her work is part of the exhibition Hip Hop Revolution, photographs by Janette Beckman, Joe Conzo, and Martha Cooper. On June 3rd at 6:30 p.m., Janette, past Cipher guest Bill Adler, and future Cipher guest Say Adams, will be part of a panel called Hip Hop's Visual Style, a look behind the scenes at the museum. We'll be there too. If you see us, feel free to come and say hi. One final note. You'll be able to see the pictures we're discussing in this interview by visiting thecyphershow.com. Go to this show's page on the website for information about how to follow along while we talk. If you like The Cipher and want to see it continue, consider making a donation at patreon.com/thecyphershow. We even have special rewards and experiences for our donors. Also, find The Cipher on iTunes. From there, you can rate, review, and subscribe so you'll never miss an episode. And now, here's a woman so persuasive that she convinced a cop to let NWA sit on the hood of their car, Janette Beckman. So I just wanted to start sort of back at the beginning, more or less, with you, that you grew up near the National Portrait Gallery.
Kind of. Well, I grew up in London, in North London, but, you know, as a kid, I used to go to the National Portrait Gallery a lot, and I used to go to the Victoria and Albert Museum, because I went to this artsy school. I went to the same school from the age of 3 to 17 years old. So I was really a product of this kind of hippie artsy school.
I would say that's the one where they like call teachers by the first name, what might be called an alternative school now.
Exactly. Exactly. Boys and girls, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, and I loved going to galleries, looking at art. And I was sort of obsessed with portraits, you know, in the National Gallery. And I guess my mom was kind of into art. She used to go to an art class once a week, painting in the evening, and I used to go with her and do my little paintings. So it was kind of meant to be.
And then the idea of like portraits and the sort of documentary painting that kind of seeped into your photography down the line.
It did. I mean, I was never really much good at history in school, but just the visuals of going to the National Portrait Gallery and looking at, you know, pictures of lords on horseback and the serfs working in the fields and all of that stuff. It was just, you know, that was the way I kind of learned about history. And it's funny when you look at Kehinde Wiley's stuff, it kind of looks like the stuff I was looking at the National Portrait Gallery. But, you know, I really thought I could be a portrait painter. That's what I wanted to be. And when I went to art school eventually after my mother forced me to do a secretarial course because you just never know what's going to happen. And that was a terrible experience. I eventually got to art school, and that was the time when David Hockney was just coming out and all of those artists. And so I was kind of a big fan of that and Egon Schiele, you know, that kind of drawing with one line. And I was really trying hard. I thought I could be a portrait artist like that. But somehow or another, after a year, I didn't think I was really good enough. And I just kind of somehow morphed into going to this photo school.
Where did photography come into the picture as something you wanted to take seriously?
Well, I was always taking pictures. Even as a kid, I had a little, you know, brownie camera like everybody does. And, you know, when I went to art school, as I say, I was really into this portrait thing, but I had a camera and I started taking pictures. And then you do this like preparatory year where you can study anything, sculpture, art, you know, painting, whatever, photography, blah, blah. And after my first year, I just suddenly, I don't know, I had my camera, I got into the photo school, and suddenly I found I was, you know, at the then London College of Printing. And I just realized I kind of loved photography, and it was the solution for me doing portraits.
And what was art school like at that time? I think to the extent, you know, people in America know anything about English art schools, it's kind of like, oh, that's where the rock stars in the 60s went before they became famous or whatever.
It's really true. Yeah. Like Pete Townsend, etc. You know, it was in the 70s, in the early 70s. And I went to St. Martin's in the beginning, and that was the hot art school. And it was wild and crazy. A lot of, you know, everybody was taking acid. So I had to learn. I didn't want to do it, but I did it. And, you know, it was a kind of wild time in London, you know, post-60s, you know, the hippie thing was in. And yeah, we were all very kind of revolutionary in the whole Oz thing. And, you know, we'd all sit plotting, you know, the downfall of the government in the local cafe and eating chocolate eclairs. I mean, rather than going to class, we'd go to class sometimes. But, you know, it was a lot of that. It was a lot of politics and a lot of, you know, pot smoking and sitting around talking. And we'd sit around talking and drawing each other. And I lived in this sort of semi-squat in Streatham, which was like the suburb.
I say, you said in one other interview that the rent you paid there, and it was typically $8 a month, or what was it?
It was something like that, £10 a month or something ridiculous. And it was owned by this very eccentric professor. He was a French professor, and the guy was really crazy. He was the uncle of a friend of mine who lived in the basement, which is how I, you know, got to the house. And he had a nudist camp in his back garden where he lived out in Reading. And all of us art students, he used to get us to go there and cut the grass and stuff for him. But we used to have to cut the grass and the nude. It was kind of crazy. You know, it was like a crazy time. And we're all pot smoking. We didn't care. We're just out there in English summer, you know, cutting grass and, you know, having a good time. But yeah, so it was kind of a tumble down house, and we all lived there, and we did a lot of art stuff. And, you know, there were people in there painting and doing collages and, you know, going to yard sales. We didn't have money, but it was great. It was really a great time.
And then after art school, you spent a couple of years teaching photography to teenagers, right?
That's right. Well, I started teaching at this local youth club called Chestnut Lodge. And that it was the time of the sort of mod revival, so the second coming of the mods. So a lot of the kids there, I guess their parents might have been mods, they'd come as mods. They'd come on their scooters all dressed up. And, you know, me, I always had my camera, so I started taking pictures of them. And that was sort of my first kind of real youth culture brush. And, yeah, I was trying to teach them photography. And then I also ended up teaching in a sixth form college that Johnny Rotten had just left there. And it was a kind of college that had a lot of squatters and, you know, kids who probably couldn't get into a university, but they were still wanted to study. So I didn't know much about teaching, but I just sort of figured it out. We'd be in the dark room and, you know, kids would be smoking pot. But I was teaching them, and it was kind of amazing because I'd been to America for the first time by then, 1975. And I bought some books when I was in America, Diane Arbus book and, you know, various other photo books. And I brought those in to the kids, and they had never seen anything like that. They were, in fact, I think, even shocked by the Diana, like the hardcore punks were even shocked by these Diana Arbus pictures.
Those are the ones, the freaks.
Yeah, the freaks and everything. They'd never seen anything like it. It was great, actually, because, you know, these kids are kind of tough kids, and they were, it was great. So, yeah, I was teaching in the school, and at that same time, one day I came out in the schoolyard, and I saw these two twins, which is one of my kind of more iconic pictures. Just standing in the schoolyard, the most stylish kids I'd ever seen, Chaka and Dubam. And they were identical twins from, I think their parents were from Nigeria. And they were dressed, you know, in full-on mod gear. They were wearing parkas and loafers. And they had the exact same face, and they finished each other's sentences. They were probably about 16 or 17 at the time. So I just went up to them and said, can I take a picture of you? And we get chatting. And I took pictures of them. Turned out they lived on the same street as me in Highbury. And, you know, later on that picture ran in the Face magazine, the first issue of the Face magazine. And then it was a few years later, 12 foot high in the Victoria and Albert Museum, which to me was kind of the biggest honor I could get.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about that. I was thinking about that picture in particular, that within a couple of years, it went from something you shot, you know, while on a break from teaching or whatever, to being in a museum. What was that transition like for you to see that shot kind of take that journey?
It was really amazing because I was always into street culture. And luckily for me, you know, I just kind of came out of college just as the whole punk, you know, mod, rockabilly, all of these different cultures were going on in London. So there was a lot of visuals on the street constantly. And, for, you know, I would always take pictures of people on the street. And I'd go to King's Road and wander up and down, take pictures of the, you know, punks that were sitting there abusing the old age pensioners on a Saturday afternoon. I was always into it. And then to actually see it in this big street style exhibit was amazing, especially as it was 12 foot high. I was thrilled. And it was great for Chaka and Dubam because they're somewhat celebrities. They still are. In fact, I did a collaboration with Ben Sherman T-shirts for the Roger Daltrey Cancer Fund last year or the year before. And the Chaka and Dubam picture is one of the best T-shirts that we made, I think. And I reconnected with the guys. They're still the same. They still dress identically. They're called the Islington Twins. They're pretty famous by now. They're like, must be at least probably late 40s, I would think. Maybe even, I don't know, they might be older.
So you mentioned, you know, mods and punks. And there were, you know, when people, you know, think of kind of London in the 70s, they have this kind of mythology that like one day, you know, there wasn't punk. And then all of a sudden in 1977, one day, you know, punk springs fully formed and people are wearing mohawks and safety pins and spikes and so forth. And like a lot of the other cultures, the mods and two-tones and so forth, like kind of get erased a little bit in the popular imagination. I was just curious, like you've sort of, what you thought about this kind of mythology that's grown up around a scene that you lived through.
Well, I was an arts, ex-art student, so I knew a lot. I mean, a lot of those people from those bands like Madness. Instance came from art school, not art school culture. So I kind of saw it developing, and it did suddenly appear like the punk thing seemed to come from, to me, well, where I was living. There's a lot of squats in Islington and around and about where I was living, so I knew a lot of those kids, you know, and so the style just kind of developed. And then, you know, suddenly all these other, the mod thing was already going, and the skinhead thing's always been in England. You know, there's always that kind of right-wing skinhead, you know, look. But now they had bands springing up. And so it was, you know, involved with the music. And of course, you know, we've got a huge West Indian population in London. So a lot of the reggae and, you know, the Clash, obviously. Worked a lot with reggae producers. And it was just a huge, it was great because there were so many different youth cultures going on at the same time. The rockabilly scene. Well, going down road with your mighty cool. I may act funny, but I ain't no fool. Rock. was going, and I used to go down to, even when I was in art school, the rockabilly scene has sort of come out of the rocker scene, you know, mods and rockers. And when I was in art school, we used to go and dance in this place called the Lyceum, where all the old rockers used to dance, and we all got our kit from, you know, jumble sales, yard sales. So I had like a full circle skirt, green on one side, black on the other, and these little crystal kind of perspex heels, and my little Elvis t-shirt that I had, and, you know, we'd go and do rockabilly dancing, and it was great with all these old dudes, and it was, you know, the music was amazing. So that culture was already big. A lot of this culture's already been going pretty much throughout the 70s. It wasn't, the punk thing was new.
Well, you have a very famous picture of a bunch of rockabilly kids, and it looks like they're actually literally worshiping an Elvis album cover. They're kind of holding it up like a, you know, well, like a talisman.
Yeah, and that was right after Elvis died. And
so it was 77 he died?
Yeah, probably, yeah. And I can't remember where that was, somewhere in East London, and I can't remember why I went there even, but, you know, I just saw them and got them together, and they happened to have this, you know, picture. And I mean, the styles are just amazing. That one guy in that picture has the most amazing hair. You know, he's really got a lot of gel in that hair. But yeah, people loved Elvis. I mean, people were also looking to America, and we also had, you know, as well as Vivian Westwood, of course, you know, and all her different incarnations at World's End, we were also getting a lot of clothes from America, like Flip. There was a store called Flip, and it had a lot of American army stuff, and, you know, like jackets and you know, Americana stuff. We loved that look as well.
And you've told the story a lot about how you got into music photography, you know, about how you brought your portfolio and then you're shooting Susie and the Banshees that evening. And what I was curious about is not so much that story, which you've told, but why you decided to go to walk into the door of that magazine in the first place.
You know, I had a little dark room on Neal Street, and it was right around there were two or three music magazines. And I loved music. I was always really into the music and into the style. And I wanted to start shooting music. And I had in my portfolio was more or less a lot of Americana that I'd shot in when I'd come on this 1975 trip after my dad passed away. My mom took me to America, and I was fascinated by the cars, and we went to Florida, the Malibu lighting, the palm trees, you know, all of that crazy American stuff, the signage, the neon. So I just decided to be brave and just walk into this magazine, and it was Sounds. And I met this woman, Vivian Goldman, who was the then, I think she was the features editor somehow, because I don't think they had a photo editor even. And she just liked me. We got along. We found out that she'd actually dated my cousin years back, which is really strange. And yeah, immediately she's like, what are you doing tonight? Go and take these pictures of Susie and the Banshees. You know, I loved Susie and the Banshees, and it was, I had never done a live picture in my life. So it was a good test.
So you went from that to shooting, you know, 2 to 3 concerts a week for a period of 4 or 5 years until you left the UK. What are some tricks you learned about getting pictures in probably some chaotic environments? Because now, you know, as you know, there's photo pits, and you go in for the first 3 songs, and it's all very nice and organized, and you're, you know, shuttled in and shuttled out. I'd imagine it really wasn't like that in those days.
Yeah, no, it wasn't actually. And because I moved from Sounds to Melody Maker, and they had a photographer there, Tommy Sheehan. He was the head photographer, and he loved rock music. And I didn't really like rock. You know, I was always the art school student going in, you know, like my pajama bottoms with a Madness t-shirt. And they were like, oh, you didn't get dressed today. And we're like, yeah, it would look like you. They're all in their cowboy boots with the jeans tucked in. You know, there were these 2 different cultures going on. So I got to shoot a lot of the bands that I wanted to shoot. And it wasn't, I would do live stuff, but I'd do more portraits. And it was, you know, sometimes, I mean, I remember being on the road, I think it was with the Undertones for 3 days.
Another girl in the neighborhood. Wish she was mine.
looks so good. I wanna hold her, wanna hold her tight. That teenage kicks right through the night.
And, you know, I was like that kid in Almost Famous. You know, I'm always trying to get my shot. And I was like, excuse me, you know, to the roadie. There's no press people or anything. So I'm like, is it time for me to get my shot? Can I take my shot now? Oh, yeah, no, the band's not here. Whatever. They've just gone to bed. You can't. Da, 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 da. So I'm supposed to be leaving. I've got my train ticket. And I'm like, excuse me, I really have to get this. And it's the cover shot and an inside spread. It was, they were just about to get on the coach to go to the next venue. So I'm looking around. You really have to think on your feet. I'm outside in the middle of Birmingham or somewhere, and I'm desperately scouting around about the parking lot to look for a good spot. I find it. And I'm like, okay, guys, everybody stand here. Click, click, click. Boom. Okay, I got to get the individual shots. Here you go. Let's put you here, you here, you here. And I did it. You know, you do it in 15 minutes because that's what you've got. And I got the live shots, obviously, because I was at the concert. And you're right, you could just be in the pit the whole time if there was a photo pit, or you just stand on the side of the stage, or, you know, you were part of the band, so you had a lot more access. It was great. You get a lot better shots, mostly.
And from that period, I do have to ask you about the John Lydon, the pictures you have with him. You have sort of two separate eras of him. You have him kind of clowning around with the Sex Pistols, you know, posing in dumpsters and rehearsing and all that stuff. And then probably not that long after, you have him at his house when he's in Public Image Limited. And, you know, it's a messy house and he's waving around guns and stuff. How had he changed between those two shoots?
Well, the first shoot, I think, was maybe one of the very first press shoots they ever did. And I did it with a friend of mine. And we were both shooting them. We just spent the day hanging out with these, you know, it seemed like four little punks. And they were just messing around. They were like kids messing around. What can we do to be naughty kind of thing? Ooh, let's go and push that boy off his bicycle. I mean, it was sort of as crazy as that. And so, you know, they were young and they were dressed up and, you know, they had the bondage gear.
Even while rehearsing, which is nuts.
No, you know,
they're
I know.
In full gear while rehearsing in one of your pictures.
And I'm sure they didn't buy that gear. I'm sure Malcolm probably got it for them. And, you know, that gear was expensive. And much as, you know, we all loved World's End, I think a lot of people used to just go in there and steal stuff because people couldn't afford it. But yeah, by the time he was just a completely different person by the time he left the band and formed Pill. And I went to his house for the second shoot. That was, you know, quite a few years later. He was just a lot more confident. He knew who he was, you know, and he was going, he knew who he'd become, shall we say. And yeah, it was just hanging out. The second shoot, I was really just hanging out with them, trying to get pictures. And actually, same Vivian was interviewing them. It was a thing for Melody Maker. And we just spent the evening there. And you're right, the house is completely messy. I was fascinated because, you know, I like to go places and look at all the ashtrays and the, you know, the posters on the wall and see the stuff that they have. There was a lot of stuff in that place and everybody was smoking pot, of course. And so I was just going around trying to get pictures of everybody. It was a whole scene. There were quite a few people there that weren't even in the band, but I figured I'd just take pictures of them. That shoot is kind of like a whole little entity unto itself, actually. It's kind of interesting. And after we'd finished that, we went down to the pub, local pub, to get a drink. And I remember we were standing outside and Johnny said he was going to piss in a beer glass. And I sort of somehow didn't have my camera out, but whatever. Another missed opportunity.
The thing that sort of transitioned into the second stage of your career and, in fact, to another country was the tour, the hip-hop tour you saw in 81, 82, somewhere around there, which was the very first international hip-hop tour, maybe the first hip-hop tour, period.
In late 1982, the appropriately titled New York City Rap Tour went to England and France. It was organized by NYC club promoter Cool Lady Blue and two Frenchmen, Jean Caracos of the record label Celluloid, and Bernard Zekri, a journalist who had already spent significant time in the burgeoning hip-hop scene in New York, and had befriended Afrika Bambaataa, among others. The tour, which was based on shows Lady Blue had been putting on at the Roxy, featured Fab Five Freddy, Cipher Episode 68 guest Grandmixer DXT, then Grandmaster DST, B-Boys, graffiti artists, MCs, and even a girls' double Dutch team.
And, you know, on the show, we've talked to DST about what that tour was like from his perspective as someone performing. What was it like for you?
It was amazing. I mean, I'd heard about it, and subject came up in the Melody Maker meeting, and I immediately put up my hand and said I wanted to shoot it. So, you know, back in the day, no cell phones or anything. They just, you know, you just go down to the hotel, and I just saw all these people that looked completely different from people that we were used to seeing in London. Just the style, everything, you know, the Buffalo boy look and the B-boy look and the... Africa Bambaataa was there in his camo jacket, and they were just hanging out. So I just was like, hi, I'm from Melody Maker. Can I take pictures? And everybody was posing for me, just hanging out in the hotel. I got a picture of Futura and Dondi by a dumpster. And I didn't know what graffiti was. I had no idea. You know, this was in the afternoon. I'm just hanging out, taking pictures and thinking, wow, I love the way these people are dressed. It's so amazing. You know, kids in these fur hats, and it just... they looked really different. So I hung out with them, and then I went to the show in the evening. It was mind-blowing because it had so many different, you know, it had breakdancing, double Dutch, you know, DJs, scratching, graffiti. Everything was going on this one stage, and I'd never seen anything like it before. It was kind of, it just blew my mind. I've said this before, it sounds crazy, but it really did. And I kind of loved the idea that the art was going on behind the music and everything was just happening all at once. And they just, I don't know, it just was super exciting to me. I loved the music immediately. And I think people in London were really, really into it. And you're right, it was the very first hip hop show we'd ever seen. And actually, I did know a little bit about graffiti because about a month before that, I had to shoot the cover of Melody Maker, the Christmas cover. And it was this guy, J. Walter Negro, painting a backdrop for our Melody Maker cover. And he's a graffiti artist, more also known as Ali. And so I rented my friend's studio, and he painted this big backdrop. And it was, you know, New York City and the train and everything. I found that really cool, too. And that very Christmas, I just was ending up going to visit a friend in New York, and... I never went back.
That's the interesting thing. It's not like you said, I'm going to move to New York City, right? You go there for a vacation and then all of a sudden, you know. So tell me about that. At what point did you look up and realize, like, hey, I guess I've moved here?
I know.
Have you hit that point yet? Is that, are you still on Christmas vacation from, you know, 1982?
I might be. It's quite possible. I don't know. It was strange because my friend was an artist and she was living in a loft on Franklin Street. And, there were a bunch of artists living there, and there was a flight attendant who had a space next door, and she traveled a lot. So they were like, oh, why don't you just stay in her loft while she's away? So after Christmas, you know, I just ended up living in this flight attendant's loft for a little bit, and it was great. I mean, frankly, my window looked onto the alley where the Mud Club was. So that was already super exciting. And then it was New York, and, you know, the loft was a big, sort of biggish artist loft, you know how they were. And it had central heating, steam heat, you know, which we didn't have in my squat that I was living in at the time. So that was kind of crazy. And I just kind of ended up, you know, I guess because I'd been exposed to this hip hop thing and then, you know, just getting on the train and the trains were all painted and the kids are walking around with boomboxes on the street and, you know, the break dancing and everything is just happening on the street. I just ended up kind of staying and getting work somehow. And the British magazines, the music magazines I'd been working for, they all knew I was here. So they started calling me and saying, oh, there's this new hip hop thing. Can you go and photograph Africa Bambaataa? You know, he's in the Bronx and here's his phone number. Yeah, it was so crazy, right?
Yeah, I mean, the thing about your pictures of Bam, there's one of them in the exhibit that we'll talk about in a second, from I think 83, where there's no mythology. It's just him in a coat and a boombox. There's no, you know, garb. There's no wraparound sunglasses. And you hardly ever see him like that.
No, I know. It's true. I just, well, that was when I went to the Bronx, 1983, and just met him. I don't even remember where. And, you know, he had, there was this wall that said Zulu Nation written just kind of really scrappily on the wall. And I got that picture that's in the show. And then I got a picture of a bunch of kids that were in the Zulu Nation around him. It was just very natural. It seemed, you know, very unposed. And you're right, because recently, last year I photographed him for this magazine I work for, Jocks and Nerds, another British magazine. And we couldn't get him to take his wraparound sunglasses off. So it's a good point. I asked, he said no. I'm like, okay.
And there are so many, you know, classic photos that you took from that era, from kind of like the early and mid 1980s. And a lot of them are collected in, you know, the exhibit you have now at the Museum of the City of New York, Hip Hop Revolution. You know, one I have to ask about that I'm sure you've talked about plenty is the sort of, you have the iconic photo of LL Cool J from, I think, 85, one of his first press shoots, the one where, you know, anyone listening to this, you know, it's the one where he has a boombox on his shoulder, you know, you know it. And so I guess more than, you know, you've talked about that photo and what it was like and what he was like and so forth a lot. I guess I'm just curious about, like, when did you realize that this was kind of the photo of this guy, the, you know, iconic photo of this guy? Or did you ever, you know, did you ever realize it?
So many artists that I photographed when they were really young, when they were just starting off in their careers, and those photos seem to have become iconic photos. And in fact, LL used that photo on his t-shirt, his tour t-shirt, last year or the year before. And it's strange. I mean, it's weird to me. You know, when he came around, he was just like a, I don't know, 16, 17-year-old kid, comes in with a boombox. I think Bill brought him around, though Bill says he doesn't remember, but I think it was Bill that brought him around. You know, I was just photographing a kid with a boombox. I had no idea that he was going to become this iconic figure in the culture. And, you know, everything about that picture, you know, he's got the Kangol hat. I mean, it's just his whole attitude, how cute he looks, you know. Ladies love Cool J. I mean, it's amazing how that photo has become iconic. I mean, a lot of, you know, I did the first three Police album covers, and when I first photographed them, they were just three punks.
And in fact, you had to lend one of them clothes for the first photo shoot you
Andy,
did with them.
Yep. That was the thing. I had an American parachute suit, and I'm small, just like Andy, so they only had two parachute suits, so he was wearing mine in the shot.
Amazing. So, you know, on some of the, you know, some of the hip hop stuff you did, you took so many iconic shots. And then around, you know, 1990, you and Bill Adler, who you just mentioned, collaborated on a book.
Right.
And, you know, it was, I think by the time it came out, it was like 1991, which was a point at which, you know, at least in the mass media, people weren't sure if hip hop was going to fade out, if it was a fad, you know, what was going on. It was like just starting to get, you know, the Newsweeks and National Magazine covers and so forth. Like, what made you decide to do a book at that point?
It actually was Bill's idea. He came around and was like, JB, you've got all these great pictures. It should be a book. And I'm going to work on it with you. And that's, you know, Bill being the man he is. We just made it happen. And it was hard getting a publisher. We ended up at St. Martin's. And crazy thing. I mean, I think we're a little bit ahead of our time, to be honest. And you're right. I mean, hip hop to us had been going on while I'd been documenting it since 82. He'd known about it, I'm sure, way longer. But it still wasn't mainstream at all. And it was hard getting a publisher. And we were told all sorts of crazy things by the St. Martin's Books marketing team, like, I hate to say this, but black people don't read, or, you know, people don't want to buy this book for their, you know, for their store because they think it'll get stolen. I mean, crazy stuff like that, which, you know, was just blowing I mean, we were just like, oh God, why are we with these people? And we'd photographed for the cover Slick Rick, who we, you know, he's an amazing looking guy and he's one of the best rhymers.
So listen to what we say, because this type of shit, it happens every day. I woke up around 10 o'clock in the morning. I gave myself a stretcher, a morning yawning. Went to the bathroom to wash up. Had some soap on my face and my hand upon a cup. I said, mirror, mirror on the wall. Who is the top choice of them all? There was a rumble dumble. 5 minutes it lasted. The mirror said,
you are, you conceited bastard.
It's classic. And unfortunately, and they'd done all this marketing material. They'd made these big posters to give out and everything, you know, with Ricky looking kind of dangerous and with all his gold and everything.
And this is the one where he's holding the tiny guns?
They weren't going to put the gun one on, funnily enough, but just him with we had a crown and tons of chains, mm-hmm. you know, same photo shoot though, where he'd brought those guns. And then he went and shot somebody. You might remember
about he shot his cousin or something.
Yeah,
right?
He shot his cousin about 3 months after. So the book publisher, because they said, "Well, we can't put somebody who's in jail on the cover of a book." And we were like, "But wait a minute, it could be really this is the guy we want. It could be really great." But they were very adamant. So we shot Big Daddy Kane, which turned out to be like a really beautiful photo anyway. But point being, I don't think St. Martin's really understood what they were getting into. And they designed the book. First, they tried to do it with this sort of cute little kind of cutesy 80s design, all pink and little pink lettering. And I was like, we can't have this. It's just not cool. We're always fighting with them. Everything, we'd come out of the meetings and Bill and I would be like, oh my God, we can't have this, we can't have that. So the book comes out in the end and it didn't really publicize it. We had to do our own press and we had a big party at SOBs with open mic and a ton of people came. And, you know, we did what we could with it. But I think we were ahead of our time. And, you know, honestly, rap was still so underground at the time.
So, you know, obviously through Bill Adler and through other people, you did stuff with Def Jam artists. And, you know, another photographer who's doing stuff with Def Jam around that same period was Glenn Friedman. Did you know Glenn? Did you guys have like a rivalry at all? How did that?
You know what? I didn't know Glenn. It was weird because I didn't really know that many photographers that were working in that genre. I mean, I was sort of working in my own little bubble. I think maybe also because I'm not from here. So, you know, I didn't grow up with these people. I mean, there were a lot of people shooting, but not actually there weren't that many people shooting it. And Glenn was also from LA, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And he was doing a lot of skateboard stuff.
Yeah.
So no, we didn't. I never really had a rivalry with anybody. I mean, you know, I got to shoot a lot of stuff and I definitely worked for a lot of those little labels like Sleeping Bag.
Yeah, I definitely wouldn't get into that in a minute. Yeah.
We'll get to Sleeping Bag in a minute.
Yeah.
But no, I just, you know, would do what I had to do. And because I was getting a lot of commissions from England too, still, you know, so I was off in my own little bubble. It was kind of funny. But, you know, I think I might have said this before, but when I came here, you know, I was a big Annie Leibovitz fan, and I thought I was going to knock her off her perch because I thought, you know, I've got the Police album covers, I've got Boy George, I've got The Clash. So I'd go into all these, you know, major record labels like EMI and, you know, whatever, Capital and everything. And they'd look at my work and they'd go, we can't use you because your work is just way too gritty. And, you know, people look rough in your pictures and, you know, street stuff isn't really flying right now. So I couldn't get any work working for a major label doing, you know, I thought I was going to do rock bands and stuff. And it was only later, you know, when I started to do all the hip hop stuff and get passed around by the artists, you know, I'd do like a shoot Salt and Pepper for a British magazine, and then they would tell Herbie, who was managing them, that I was cool, and then he would tell, you know, their label, and they would hire me for the first album cover.
Sure. You did Herbie's compilation album,
right? I shot Herbie a lot, but you know, he was managing Salt and Pepper. I shot Salt and Pepper. Then, so, you know, they would say, Herbie, you know, that we met this English photographer, why doesn't she do our album cover, because she seems nice. And that's kind of how I got passed around. Then I got, you know, ended up doing Dana Dane and Antoinette, other, you know, people on his label. Just kind of getting passed around more by the artists. And then, you know, starting to work with these small labels. You know, it's just a different way of getting work. But I loved it. I was so into it. And I loved all the music and I loved the whole culture. So it was great for me.
It's funny. In some ways, your Salt and Pepper shot had a new life recently, when they just did a commercial where they're dressed basically almost exactly how you shot them for what was like a single cover or something, the sort of iconic shot of the three of them in the jackets and stuff.
That's right. I know. And I think there's a Dapper Dan jackets, by the way, and they look amazing. And that style, that Salt and Pepper, that is the Salt and Pepper style. And people still today talk about dressing up like Salt and Pepper. Yeah. And it's a whole thing. where, you know, you'd wear those jackets, you know, the boots and everything. It's, and, you know, obviously the earrings. They invented a whole style. And
like you're saying, that still is salt and pepper, right? Dressed up as them, their 80s selves for a commercial. They wore basically those outfits.
Yeah, that Geico commercial. They looked unbelievable. They looked the same.
Salt and pepper, you tell people to push it.
Push it real good.
That's what you do. If you want to save 15% or more on car insurance, you switch to Geico. It's what you do.
I'm pushing it real good.
I mean, they don't seem to have aged, and it's 30 years later. I love that. The Push It Geico commercial is brilliant and good for them. You know, I've always been a big fan of theirs, partly because I shot them before they'd even made a record. So, and I always got along with them really well, and I did a lot of work with them, you know, over the years. I mean, there was one shoot that we did. It was maybe for the third or fourth album, and they wanted to be dressed up like gangsters. And so we got a stylist, and, you know, we got all these clothes, and a hair and makeup person. This was kind of later on. And everybody was at my studio, and then everybody, you know, we kind of hanging around. We're going, where's Pepper? And I'm like, oh, we forgot to tell her. She's in Florida. So we're like, oh, okay, well, I guess we're not shooting this today. We'll shoot it next week. I mean, things like that would happen all the time. But, you know, I love those girls. I just think they're coolest. And they, to me, were, you know, the first girls to kind of answer back as sort of pretty much male-dominated culture. They had a lot to say, and they're very funny about it.
So a couple specific questions about some of your photos that I've kind of always wondered about. First off, you did the cover of the Run-DMC Mary Mary single. Was that at all modeled on the cover of the Monkees Mary Mary single? Because there are some similarities between the design of the two covers.
I have not seen the Monkees Mary Mary single. That's really interesting. I maybe need to take a look at that. No, not in my view, but maybe there was some person who was doing art direction at the time who did. That's fascinating.
All this right. Is a Monkees cover.
Oh.
Right?
Yeah.
I thought it was an homage when I...
Funny.
Yeah. Yeah.
I had no
somebody
idea.
Somebody must have influenced that.
Is this the same song?
Yeah, it's the same.
Is it a
one they sampled. It's the one they sampled for it.
Really funny.
Yeah.
Okay, I had no idea that it was a sample song because, you know, I probably didn't even know that the Monkees ever did that song.
Yeah.
I just remember, hey, hey, we're the Monkees.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah. And I just heard an interview with Cool Keith not long ago where he was talking about the Critical Beatdown cover that you shot. And he was saying that, like, the sort of full uncut version of that picture, there's a little more in there. They're kind of like maybe icons representing other rappers at the time that they're stepping on or whatever. Is any of that true? I know he can sort of get carried away with stuff.
It's absolutely true. And actually, I have that photo. I should put it up on my blog or something.
Wow.
Yeah, they had a bunch of their friends dressed as like LL Cool J and various other, I think there was a kid or a kid in play or something. And we went to this, you know, destroyed building area somewhere on the, I think, Avenue D or something. It's like this huge pile of rubble. And we had everybody lying in the rubble and they're stepping on them. You know, they're standing on top of them. And all these guys are lying in the ground. You know, I've got to find that shot.
Yeah. And that, you know, so the actual thing that made the cover of the album, they just cut that part out.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, they don't. Yeah. But that actually is, yeah, I guess that's the B-roll for that. He's absolutely right.
Wow.
I know. I kind of love that ultra magnetic.
And so you were talking about how you did stuff for labels like Sleeping Bag and you know, Sleeping Bag and Fresh and Wild Pitch and Tommy Boy and stuff like that. The kind of
Plateau.
Independent. Yeah,
Plateau. Yep.
What were those sessions like? Did the labels give you any direction? Was it just you and the artists, specifically for like the independents at that time?
It's funny. It really varied. I mean, I think they knew that I knew how to photograph people. And so, you know, a lot of Sleeping Bag had, the art director was this woman, Zoe Brotman, and I think she designed the logo for them. And so she would sometimes come on the photo shoots and, you know, we'd get various, you know, obviously she'd art direct a little bit and get some shots. But, you know, we'd sometimes, or they'd say, oh, we want a yellow backdrop or, you know, a green backdrop or whatever. Or, you know, with EPMD, I went to shoot them in the studio. You know, they'd give me locations and things. But, yeah, pretty much, I don't know, I was pretty much left on my own to kind of figure stuff out. And it's funny, I just had lunch with Will Sokoloff from Sleeping Bag.
Right.
Literally 2 days ago, we were talking about the old days and how great it was and the freedom that we had. And we were also talking specifically about that Just Ice photo shoot.
I was going to ask you about Just Ice, yeah.
Yeah, Just Ice. Well, it's funny because I remember distinctly I had this studio on Lafayette Street, sort of in a building that had Tower Books in it eventually. And I remember them telling me, oh, this guy, Just Ice, you're going to have to photograph him. He's coming down and he just beat a murder rap in D.C. And, you know, he's a scary guy, big guy, but don't be frightened. I was like, whatever. So it was a studio, going to be a studio photo shoot and a few outdoor shots. So the guy comes in, super nice, you know, big, huge guy. Just Ice is a big dude. He's obviously, he's got Justice written on his teeth, you know, in gold caps. And, you know, he wasn't really scary to me. He just seemed like a kind of nice, big guy. And we got all the shots and we wandered around on the streets, you know, and got some outdoor shots. And it was kind of, you know, just like normal business. And afterwards, we went across the street, and I think it was a Time Cafe was open across the street, to get some Long Island iced teas. And I'd never had a Long Island iced tea before. And that was a big experience, my first Long Island iced tea with Just Ice. And we're, you know, eating some chips and dip and stuff. And I remember him taking his, you know, his caps out, wiping them really neatly and putting them in his top pocket. I was like, okay, I can see, Zay, you don't want to get the chips caught in the... In between the caps. I was like, okay, I get it. So I got a little drunk with Just Ice and we had a big long chat and we had a good time hanging out. And then a few days later, it's ringing on my doorbell. And he's going, hey, JB, it's Justice. Can I come up for a minute? I'm like, oh, okay, whatever. You know, he comes up, he goes, I want to show you something. And he's got this little box and he opens the box and in the box is this tiny little kitten. And he's going, I just adopted this little kitten. And I wanted to show it to you. And his name, we're calling him Money Clip. And I was like, you know, this is the guy who's just beat a murder rap. I mean, you can only, you know, you've got to take people as you find them. That's all I have to say.
Amazing. And, you know, there's, you know, I mean, we could go on forever, obviously, about some of your hip hop shots and things. But, I was amazed by, you know, in the exhibition, you have a whole series of Polaroids, you know, just stuff you would take, you know, towards the end of the shoot and you would have the artist sign it as I'm assuming is kind of a memento. And you have one of NWA and Easy signed the picture, Stay Sweet, Eazy-E. And I just thought that was so...
It's my favorite Polaroid. You know, I used to do Polaroids because, you know, that's how we did lighting tests back in the day. Because remember, it wasn't digital. It was all film. So I always used to take Polaroids and then, you know, I'd have the artist sign them right as a memento before they left. And, you know, and that NWA shoot was so weird because I went to shoot them for my book with Bill because I thought we didn't have enough West Coast rappers. And so I spent like a week or two in L.A., getting hold of these guys, and they were recording. And so they said, oh, you can just come to the studio, but we don't really have time. You know, the usual thing, they didn't want to stop. So I get there and I drag them outside. They're not really into it, but I drag them outside and there's like this little alley around the corner. So I just took a single shot. Like maybe I had my Hasselblad, you know, it's only 12 shots on a roll. So I put them in the alley and, you know, there's a few little doorways, so I'm trying to get one shot of each one. I got, you know, two shots of Eazy-E, two shots of Dr. Dre, you know, two shots of each one. And then I want to do a group shot. So I've got them on the street outside the studio. They don't want to go anywhere. And I see this cop car coming down the street, and they just released Fuck the Police. So I was like, oh, I'm going to flag down this cop car. So I'm standing in the middle of the street, flagging down this cop car. And he stops, and I was like, excuse me, do you mind if I just take a picture of this band in front of your police car? And he was like, oh, no. I mean, I think, you know, being a small British woman helps in these circumstances. They're not suspicious of me. So put the guys up against the car. They looked a little nervous. And I get the shot. And then, you know, I'm like, thank you, sir. And he drives off. And that's how I got my shot. But, yeah, stay sweet. And then, you know, I mean, there is... I think I've told this story before, shall I say it?
About they tried to get you in to do a skit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think they like my British accent. Easy, really like my British accent. He's like, oh, could you come in and just read something? Because we're recording now. We just want you to read this thing for our new album. So, you know, I'm like all excited, thinking, oh, great, I'm going to be on the NWA album. And he gives me this piece of paper, and on the piece of paper is a description, lurid description of how to give the perfect blowjob. And I just, you know, it was my kind of feminist era. I just couldn't get to it. And
it did still end up on the album.
Went out and bought NWA's new book entitled The Art of Sucking Dick.
Lesson one. First, you grab the dick. Next, you gently lick it up and down.
Then I suffice to say, yeah. I didn't do it, but somebody else probably did.
Yeah, yeah.
Or maybe they, I don't know. I really? Sort of wish I had now. Whatever.
So you mentioned about, you know, in getting the cops' attention that like it helped because you were, you know, British and sort of unassuming in that way. And I wanted just for a second to talk about, do you think that being British helped you to get along with a lot of the rap artists in a sense that the baggage of being a white American photographing black artists sort of wasn't, maybe was different. It wasn't there.
I do. I really do. And I think, you know, I didn't really understand the way the racism thing works here when I got here. Because, you know, when you're in England, you grow up really... I mean, I grew up listening to Motown, and we revered it. We pretty much all my friends revered Black Soul, Tamla, you know, disco, all that American black music. That's what we loved. We never... And when I got here, I didn't really understand how the whole racism thing worked and the black charts and the white charts and all of this stuff. So actually being a Brit, I think, was extremely helpful because a lot of times, you know, when I was here in the early 80s, people didn't really travel that much. People didn't have money. You know, bands weren't traveling and they hadn't really seen too many Brits, let alone having them turn up, you know, at their mom's house to take a picture of their pop group. So it was actually great, you know, and they were curious about what it was like in England. And I'm like fascinated by their lives. So it's great. And I'm, you know, I always believe that my photos are a true collaboration between me and the artist rather than me telling them what to do. I try and figure out what they want to do and help, you know, I want to capture them, you know, in that documentary National Portrait Gallery way of, you know, the way they are, sort of capture a moment. So, you know, a lot of that involves chatting and making people feel comfortable. And I think definitely being a white British woman, well, being a British woman helped.
Yeah.
And they probably didn't have preconceptions about me and who I was. They were interested to find out who I was.
And I noticed that, you know, looking at your discography, the album covers and single covers and stuff you did, basically by the end of 91, you'd all but stopped doing hip hop stuff. I mean, I think you did, you know, one or two things in 92, but you know, it being the majority of the stuff you shot had sort of petered out by then. Was that because you'd noticed it sort of was starting to turn into big business?
It was a mixture of things. I mean, I kind of loved it so much during the 80s, and it had that really fresh... I mean, I think it was... You're right. It started to turn into big business and, you know, MTV. And, you know, it was before MTV, before the internet, and before... I mean, people would... It was very similar to punk to me, you know, in the, you know, economy was bad when I got here and people didn't have money and people had to invent stuff. And it was incredibly innovative and exciting and fresh and from the street. And then, you know, in the early 90s, big record labels started to take over and dictate the way it should be and dictate what artists should wear. And it was more about making money rather than making, you know, art, shall we say. So, yeah, I guess it started to change for me. And strangely, I started to get work for magazines like Glamour, photographing, you know, Woman of the Year. They'd send me around the country photographing, you know, politicians and, you know, Martina Navratilova and, you know, all sorts of other strange jobs. And I was working a lot for the Daily News magazine at the time, doing a lot of shoots of all sorts of, you know, artists and writers and people like that. So I don't know, my work just started to change. It was interesting. It seemed like things definitely changed around that early 90s.
I do have to ask, I want to show you an album cover that of yours that you might not even remember.
Uh-oh.
And I do have to ask about it and what, if anything, you remember about Charlie Singleton.
Oh,
Man, Nothing Ventured, Nothing Gained.
That's amazing. I haven't seen that in a long time. Was he in the Isley Brothers or something?
I don't know.
Let's look him up. I mean, at that time, by that sort of later time, I'd started to get work from some of the bigger labels, too. And I shot Tracy Chapman. They were trying to get a good press shot for her. And I think they'd had 5 different photographers shoot her. And, you know, kind of expensive photographers. And eventually they're like, let's try Janette.
Oh, he was in Cameo.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't remember a lot about it, other than I kind of love that picture. I kind of need that. That's amazing. It's very 80s.
Yes, very, very, very 80s. We'll have it up on the website, but it's a shirtless guy holding a pink guitar.
Fabulous.
Yeah, really very, very
great
at the time. So since we're in Harlem, it only seems right to ask you about your time photographing a dirt bike gang, uptown dirt bike gang known as the Go Hard Boys. Can you tell us a little bit about them and how you ended up taking pictures of them?
I work for this British, I'm the New York editor for this British magazine called Jocks and Nerds. And I'm always looking for, you know, rebel culture stories for them, because they're pretty much the only people that will run those stories. And I love shooting that stuff. It's, you know, I would shoot it anyway, but it's nice, you know, for the people if it gets into a magazine. So someone told me about this dirt bike club, and I gave me the phone number of Shay, who's one of the founders of it. So I ended up coming up to Harlem and meeting him, and we sat around, you know, on his stoop one afternoon and had a chat, and I showed him my hip-hop book, and we just kind of really got along. We were both wearing the same sneakers. We were sitting out there chatting, and he's like, sure, I could get some of the guys together. So the Go Hard Boys are a group of dirt bike riders who live in Harlem on about 148th Street, and Shay is one of the founders, and it's illegal to ride dirt bikes in the city. These guys live to bike, you know, it's what they live for. And it's a lot less expensive probably to have a dirt bike than to have, you know, a regular bike. And also, if you have a small one, you could possibly bring it into your apartment, keep it in there, or, you know, there's a lot of great things about it. So anyway, I ended up going up to Harlem one afternoon and hanging out with them. And he got this big group of bikers together for me. And we did some portraits of them. And then he had his cousin here. And she had a Ford F-150 truck. So, you know, I ended up, it's a hot summer's day, in the back of the truck on the flatbed, like hanging out the back with my camera, photographing these guys on the Bruckner Expressway. And Shay is like sitting next to me going, isn't this really scary for you? And I was like, you have no idea how happy I am at this moment. It was just so great. So these guys, I photographed them. They hang out a lot and they ride around a lot in the Bronx. And if you're in Harlem, you can often see them doing tricks. They do lots of wheelies. They're really good riders.
Yeah, we can see them out the window here often.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
But this is probably their route, actually. And they're the nicest guys. And a lot of their culture is, you know, about keeping kids off the street and away from drugs and into bikes, which is a great thing. I mean, they even have little 6-year-olds sort of riding little tiny bikes. And you can just hanging out with them, and you can see people practicing on their bicycles, you know, when they're not old enough to have bikes. It's just a whole street culture, and I kind of love that. So yeah, I'm good friends with them now, and pretty much anytime they need photos, I'm there. I'll take portraits for them, whatever they need. They're making a movie. I mean, there was already that movie. I think it's called The 12 O'Clock Boys. But I think Shay's movie is going to be a bit different, and it's going to be great. I can't wait for it to come out. And I've shown those pictures in various places. Actually had an exhibition of them in Omaha, Nebraska. So they're kind of, we're spreading the word.
Yeah, where when you were in Omaha, I know you were an artist in residence there. You took some shots of the rodeo.
I did. Yeah, I was an artist in residence at Bemis last year in Omaha, Nebraska, and that just I randomly met a woman who was curating the artists there, and she was like, "Oh, do you want to come?" And I went. I spent 2 months there. It was really interesting because I wanted to photograph people on the street, as I do, sort of street culture. But there is nobody on the street in Omaha. I had soon found out that people don't hang out on the street whatsoever, you know, because it's a very divided city. I think it has the poorest population, which is usually the African-American, and then the richest. Obviously, you've got your Warren Buffetts and so on. So it's a really strange place. And I was having an exhibition in this place called Carver Bank, and it's a little tiny gallery in the middle of the African-American, pretty poor neighborhood. So my idea was to show hip-hop pictures and also the Go Hard Boys, because I wanted people from the neighborhood to actually look in the window and go, oh, I can relate to this, and actually come into the gallery rather than just have it be for other artists, which, you know, is kind of ridiculous to me. So it turned out to be great. The show was great. And I was looking for alternative cultures. It was quite challenging for me because I couldn't find anybody to shoot. So I just ended up talking to a lot of people. I shot a black biker barbecue, which was really cool. And I've always wanted to shoot a rodeo. So I shot this rodeo, the River City. Is it the River City Rodeo or Two Rivers Rodeo? I think it's the first or second largest rodeo in the country. And it was amazing. And I ended up meeting one of the organizers and got a pass and shot all the cowboys and the bulls. I went out and photographed a steer wrestler on his farm, and it was really great. It was a great experience. I mean, those bull riders are no joke, because a bull, when I'm there, you know, in the rodeo, because I had great access, and it's like riding a small SUV. I mean, those things are massive. And, you know, you got some 22-year-old cowboy holding a rope.
Right, an SUV that you can't drive.
Right, because exactly. It just does what There's it wants. No yeah. driving it. Exactly. It was really wild, actually. Yeah. So I ended up shooting a lot of stuff. I shot the Labor Day parade there, which was incredible, because you just get everybody, old people, young people. And it's strange, because it was sort of something about Omaha reminded me of photos I'd seen of America in the 60s or something. It's got that kind of 1960s, a lot of kind of old warehouses and built, probably nothing's changed. It's an interesting place.
One other kind of New York-centric street culture I wanted to ask you about was the sort of underground Brooklyn Girls Fight Club. And I honestly only found out that even existed a few months ago when by chance I ran into one of the organizers. I don't think he's involved anymore, but who had been one of the organizers and who told me about it. But you went and took some pretty incredible close-up pictures of this whole, exactly what it says, underground fight club.
Yeah, a couple of friends of mine were making a documentary about it, and it specifically centered around a couple of the women who fight, who are actually, you know, single moms trying to get out of Brownsville. And so they wanted some still shot, and they asked me if I would come along. And I have to say, it was maybe one of the more frightening experiences. Just, I went
with... And this, by the way, coming from a woman who spent an entire summer with a Mexican street gang.
I think it was, you know, I was in Brownsville. We went out to Brownsville, and I had my friend Ben with me, and they had this underground fight club. It's illegal in this big, huge cement one-story garage. And, you know, they set up a ring there, and all, I think it's sponsored by the local, pretty much boys in the hood, probably drug dealers, and people bet on the fights, and it's girls' fights, and they're not wearing gloves. They're just, you know, it's pretty hand-to-hand, it's pretty violent, and the scary thing is you're trapped in this garage with sort of pit bulls chained up in the back. And, you know, you're locked in. They search everybody, strip searching everybody. Well, searching everybody. And I realized, you know, it's in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of winter, you know, and I realized if somebody, you know, wanted to get like a little crazy in that spot, you know, something bad could really go down. So first time in my life, I kind of thought, I'm a little hesitant to start going up to some of these characters. And the place was packed. But then I thought, well, I'm here now. I got to get going. So I pick up my camera and I just started going up to like the most badass looking guys and going, is it okay if I take a picture? And then, of course, you know, they're all posing for me. And then everybody suddenly knows I'm there and they're asking to take pictures. And, you know, I get to shoot the fights. And the fights, I think they're 3 minutes long, and I think the winner gets $500 or something. I can't remember the exact amounts, and the loser gets something. But they're really violent. I mean, they're literally, they're girls, you know, 14 and up, you know, tearing each other's hair. I mean, someone's weave came out in someone's hand. I mean, it was crazy. It's really crazy. And people are betting on it, and there's a lot of screaming and shouting. The noise is intense. It was a really crazy scene. And then I ended up going with the documentary filmmakers to these people's houses and shooting them with their families and their grandmothers and the kids and finding out the whole scene, you know. I mean, this one woman was wanting to get her kids out of the neighborhood because it's a pretty drug-riddled neighborhood and moved to Pennsylvania. And so she was trying to get money. That was how, you know, she thought she could get some money to get out. And she ended up leaving. So it was frightening, but it was an amazing, intense experience that I'll never forget.
Yeah. And, you know, the thing you were saying about going up to people and asking to take their pictures, you still do street portraits.
I do.
Right?
I do.
I mean, you must have thousands at this point. Why keep doing it?
You know, I'm just fascinated by people. I can't, it's like an addiction. It might be my one addiction. I just kind of, you know, even sitting on the train, you know, I'm looking at people going, wow, he looks interesting. I should go and take a picture of him. I can't help myself, and I still do it to this day. And, you know, I kind of have this thing. Jamel Shabazz, I talk to him about it quite a bit because he's like the king of street portraits to me. He's taken so many brilliant pictures. And we agree, you know, you approach people with respect and talk to them and ask their permission and, you know, collaborate with them. And I kind of feel that's the way to go. I don't know. I'm just fascinated by people.
Yeah, you have a whole series of, I think you spent like 3 or 4 years in the 90s taking street portraits in New York, and no one's ever seen them, right?
They haven't, actually. Actually, Sean Corcoran at the Museum of the City of New York seen them, and he's about the only one.
Wow. And would you ever exhibit those? I feel like, you know, now that so much time has passed, it's kind of must be a crazy time capsule.
It is a crazy time capsule, and it's all sorts of people because... right. That's right after, you know, when I sort of stopped doing hip hop around 91, 92, I started really getting into this street portrait thing. And I just get on the train with my Hasselblad and just go to a different stop, like somewhere out in far flung Queens or somewhere in Brooklyn or whatever, get out and just walk around and go up to people and ask if I could take pictures. So, you know, it's everybody from kids on the street to, you know, a Hasidic family in Coney Island to you name it. It's like, it is a sort of portrait in a way of that time in New York and the styles. And, you know, I liked shooting stuff on the street because, you know, you see the shop signs and what's in the shops and, you know, the cars and everything just kind of gets this little sense of history there. Yeah, I'd love to have a show of those one day. That would be really awesome.
And, you know, that brings me to, you know, something I wanted to ask about where you are now, which is photography is a very different entity now than when you started at the very, you know, to start with, there's technology, right? Like, obviously, I know even you shoot digitally at least sometimes, but you obviously had years of working with film. What do you think that people who are starting photography in a world where they never had to deal with film, what are they missing?
Well, when we shot with film, every shot had a price on it. And, you know, we didn't have money at the time. So, you know, if you went to do a photo shoot and you took three rolls of film, you knew it was going to cost you, you know, $30 or whatever by the time you had to develop and print, blah, blah. So I think it made you much more selective. I mean, these days with digital, you see people just shooting without paying any attention to the framing. They're just hoping that they get a shot randomly. Oh, let me take a shot, or let me take that same shot 20 times just to make sure. I think it makes people much less thoughtful. And shooting with film has been a great training. And, you know, it makes you much more aware of what's going on and looking. You know, I don't really do a lot of Photoshop on my images. I don't really like working on the computer that much. I mean, I'll, you know, play with the levels a little bit, but I try and get it right the first time. And I think people with digital are like, oh, just shoot it, and we'll fix it in Photoshop later, which to me is a really ass-backwards way of taking a portrait of somebody.
Right. And you have, you know, Instagram, of course, which has sort of brought the idea of filters, you know, popularized it in a sort of, you know, they have sort of filter presets in a way that people are used to seeing.
Yeah, I mean, I love Instagram. I'm quite a big Instagrammer. My Instagram is Janette Photo, by the way. And it's fun. And I use it myself to just, you know, shoot things on the street that I see, you know, like little bits of graffiti art, or, you know, I don't know, some dead rat on the street or whatever it is, or some kid I just saw walking along, whatever. I like doing postings on Instagram. It's a lot of fun, and it's a good way to look at other people's work. Mm-hmm. I'm not so crazy about the filters. I mean, I haven't found the perfect one yet.
Right.
I'm waiting for somebody to bring out the Tri-X filter so I can make my digital look like Tri-X, which would be great. I think it's going to happen soon.
And so more generally, you know, with print, you know, obviously not being what it was, you know, print magazines being on the decline, you know, digital photography kind of being so easy. How do you continue to make a living as a photographer?
It's a really good question. I'm wondering about that. No, well, I sell my archive prints, you know, and luckily for me, I photographed a lot of iconic bands that people want pictures of. So I sell those. So that's one way. I have exhibitions. And, you know, I work for various magazines. I just actually shot the New York Commissioner of Health on Saturday for a no smoking campaign she's doing. You know, I'm still doing portraits. And so I still get hired for certain things. And, you know, whatever. I think the freelance life, if you're a freelancer, you have to get used to the ups and downs. And, yeah. That's just the way it goes.
And you've done some corporate stuff, right? With, you know, Kangol and Ben Sherman and
oh, totally,
like
yeah.
Stussy and, you
know, yeah, some places. Of the street brands have hired me a lot. I've done a lot of campaigns for Kangol, and, you know, I like them as a brand, and they're kind of so connected to hip hop. So it's a great thing, you know, for me, and I can still happen to like rocking a Kangol hat from now and again. So I've done a few campaigns for them. Couple in England, a few here. And yeah, I work for Shot, the leather jacket company. I've done some stuff for them, for Shot Japan and Shot America. And yeah, street brands seem to like my style, I think, because it's sort of real and gritty. So finally, that whole not gritty things come full circle, and I can actually make money from what I like doing.
Yeah.
It's strange because in some ways, I don't really think my style has changed that much. When I look at portraits I'm shooting now, you know, the portraits I shot back in the day, mm-hmm. It's pretty much the same, a similar type of style and aesthetic. So it's funny. It's just come full circle.
And one thing that, you know, important part of the exhibit you have now at the Museum of City, New York, is you have the mashups where you, a collaboration where you took archival prints and different graffiti artists would sort of go to work on them and turn them into something new. How did the idea for that come about?
A woman called Juliet, who does pop-up art events, she came to Say Adams and I last June. She wanted to do a pop-up art event with us. And we knew her from before. We liked her a lot. And so we just were having this lunch meeting to try and decide what we were going to do. And Say suddenly says, you know what? I'm going to get my friends to draw on Jeanette's photos. I was like, what? They're not going to want to draw on my photos. Why are they going to? And he's like, yeah, they will. So we decided, you know, he gave us a list of all the artists, which are all his friends. And it's iconic guys like T-Kid, you know, right from, you know, part one. trash now. We've got Zephyr, we've got all sorts, as well as new artists, and a lot of our female artists, Claw and Alice and all these people. So we just sent out an email which had a PDF attached with a bunch of photos, like hip-hop photos, and just like, do you want to be a part of this? Choose one. I'm going to send you a print. And I gave them each a print as a gift for doing it, by the way. So they each got a signed print of whatever they wanted. And they all wanted to do it. And we had this little exhibition in my, where I live, in my apartment in the city. And 400 people turned up to the opening. We didn't even publicize it. So this is massive thing. And I don't know. I really love it, because it's also in some ways very kind of hip hop punk, making something new out of something old. And, you know, also the fact that we've got legends from the early 70s to now working on my art. It's just so incredible. I just love it. I love the way it turned out. And I took the show to Paris and people loved it there. People were buying prints. I mean, it's a really beautiful piece of art, I think, the whole thing. And we got 20 artists now. We started off with about 10, and now we've got 20. So really excited about it. I think it's great. And, you know, it's pretty much down to say who drew on a Keith Haring picture. And we asked every artist why they chose that particular photo, what was their connection with that art, you know, that piece. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we asked them when they started, you know, drawing, and we have a little questionnaire. It's great. It's really great. It's a little piece of history encapsulated.
And finally, one final thing that I couldn't let you come through without asking about.
Uh-oh.
Is I saw, you know, buried in the hidden depths of YouTube somewhere is about 8 minutes of a TV pilot you did back in 92 called NYC, S-E-E. What exactly was that? Like, I watched it. I'm still not exactly sure what it was.
Hi, I'm Victoria Wilson James, and each week on NYC, we'll be bringing you a half an hour guide to what's on in New York City.
Let's talk about sex.
How interesting that you could find that. Yeah, I guess I've forgotten that's up there. Back in, oh gosh, I guess it was in the 90s, actually. That was another thing I started doing. I've forgotten about that. In the early 90s, the same Vivian Goldman who keeps popping up, she and I were working on this pilot, and this was before New York One. And it was supposed to be pretty much like a New York One TV program. It was called NYC, N-Y-S-E-E, and we had a theme tune written by Eagle Eye Cherry. And, you know, we went out and we were talking about what was going on in New York and went out and interviewed people. We interviewed Simon Doonan from Barney's, and we, you know, the Amato Opera, and we did a thing on like...
R.I.P. to the Amato Opera, by the way.
R.I.P. to the Amato Opera, I know.
Very sad.
Yeah, and it was really great. We did a thing on art. We did a street, you know, street market thing in Brooklyn. It was a pilot, and this guy was producing it. It was, you know, and he was trying to sell it, but he couldn't sell it. I think it was a little ahead of his time.
And it never aired?
It never aired.
Yeah.
But it was before New York One. And then suddenly New York One pops up and I'm like, oh, they took our idea. But yeah, it was great. It was really a lot of fun working on it. And I was kind of helping and all, you know, I was doing B-roll and helping interviewing and setting up interviews. So much fun and good way to find out what was going on in New York too.
Well, we'll definitely link to, you know, the little bit of
episode
that is out there.
That's so cool that you found that.
Yeah.
I love that.
Excellent. So you have the exhibit going on at the Museum of City in New York. There's some live events going on around that.
Actually, Bill and I are doing a talk, I think in June, which is going to be, you know, about creating identities for, you know, record label artists. So that could be pretty interesting. And we've been doing workshops for kids where kids get to do their own mashups on my photos. It's been super fun. And they've done some great pieces of art. And yeah, there's a lot of events going on. And actually, it's a great show. And, you know, I have to give a shout out to my fellow photographers in the show, Martha Cooper. And I've been a massive fan of her work since I first saw it at Powerhouse Books. Joe Conzo, who I met about 6 years ago, he has the Born in the Bronx book, and he has the early birth of hip hop. I mean, photos, I wish I'd been there, Joe. That's all I have to say. So much respect to these two. and I'm sort of honored to be in a show with you guys. That's all I have to tell you.
Well, Hip Hop Revolution, photos by Janette Beckman, Joe Conzo, and Martha Cooper through September 15th at the Museum of the City of New York. Very, very, very highly recommended. And Janette Beckman, thanks for coming through and talking to us.
Thanks for having me, guys. This was super fun, and thanks for the tea.
It was a real privilege to be able to do this episode. Janette is often asked only to talk about the same small handful of her pictures, so I was glad to be able to engage with her about the whole course of her career, from London and the beginnings of punk rock all the way through rodeos in Omaha. As far as rap goes, it was cool to be able to get the so many stories behind her classic images. From the first international hip-hop tour, to Ultramagnetic MC's censored album cover, to her near appearance on a pretty dirty NWA skit, she's been a part of so many key moments, and I'm glad she was able to share them on this show. If you're in or near New York this summer, make sure to see Janette's photos at the Museum of the City of New York. And if you can, you should make it to her panel there on June 3rd. Recent panels there have featured Crazy Legs, DJ Red Alert, Wild Style director Charlie Ahern, and that's just in the audience. Visit mcny.org for more info. Next week, we talk to Blueprint. The Columbus rapper with the boombox and the powerful voice is known both for his solo work and his collaborations with RJD2 as the group Soul Position. He has a new album called King No Crown and is currently on tour to support it. He was also part of the underground supergroup The Orphanage with Illogic, Slug, Idea, Aesop Rock, and former Cipher guest Sage Francis. You can find The Cipher on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at The Cipher Show. Hit us up. Let us know what you thought of this week's show, ideas for future guests, anything you'd want to talk about. Also, you can find all of our episodes online for free at thecyphershow.com. And remember, consider making a donation at patreon.com/thecyphershow. And make sure to rate, review, and subscribe on iTunes. The Cipher is created and written by Sean Sotaro.
You know, this is the guy who's just beat a murder rap.
The show is produced and engineered by Josh Cross at Crosstown Studios.
So I ended up coming up to Harlem and meeting him, and we sat around, you know, on his stoop one afternoon and had a chat, and showed him my hip-hop book.
Our music is by 42 Ghosts.
And it was great with all these old dudes. And it was, you know, the music was amazing.
We'll see you next time around on The Cipher.
Yeah. I mean, it's just so great the way your head sticks up over this box. Thank you.
Of course.
Okay.